Please stand for the Gospel of our Lord, Matthew 4, 1 through 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against the stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and to their splendor. And he said to them, "All these I will give to you, if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Something about wilderness that enchants us and scares us. It just is. There is something about wilderness that is both enchanting and frightening. The desert places, where there isn't a law of civilization, have a very stark and eerie beauty. And at the same time, have a sense that something is foreboding or frightening. A year ago, when we were in the Grand Canyon, on one hand, you sit there and you look over the South Rim and you just tear up because the beauty is so incredible. And then you start walking down a trail, and all of a sudden you realize that there is like 6 inches between you and a straight drop-off, and there is no rail. And you freeze. At least that was my experience. You just freeze. And you look, and you don't want to go forward or backward for fear. And so all of a sudden you find yourself stepping as far as you can over. There's something charming and exhilarating and something foreboding and frightening about the wilderness, about the desert places, about the nature that is not civilized. And I suppose that is why we are so drawn to them and so repelled from them. For 33 years, my wife and I have had this ongoing debate about the whole concept of camping. I don't want to go. She does. I have this idea that it took humankind 6,000 years to perfect the inner spring mattress. Why would I want to go sleep in a sleeping bag on the ground somewhere out in the middle of nowhere? But at the same time, when you go out there, it is enchanting. But visiting it is a little different than sleeping in it, I think. There is something about the wilderness that is enchanting and foreboding all at the same time. And so, we find Jesus right after one of the high moments of his life. You all know the story. He has just been baptized by John the Baptizer. There are crowds everywhere. And all of a sudden, there is a dove that descends and a voice from heaven that is heard. This is my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. And you gotta believe that that would make Jesus really feel confident. Would really feel strong and empowered. Would really make him ready to just hit the ground running and do what God wants him to do. I mean, think about times when somebody has pulled you aside and said, you know, you really are good at this. Doesn't that make you feel good? Doesn't that make you feel empowered? Think about the time when somebody walked up to you and said, you know, you said something or you did something that just made all the difference in my life. Doesn't that make you feel empowered? Doesn't that make you feel really good? I mean, can you imagine Jesus feeling that 1,000 times over? This is my beloved with whom I am well pleased. And if there was any reason why he wouldn't get up out of that water and begin his ministry, after that, I don't know what it would be. But he pauses. He senses a call to go into the wilderness, to find those desert spaces in his life. And he spends 40 days there. And during his 40 days, St. Matthew tells us that he had a succession of conversations with the dark one, with the evil one. And in these conversations, he has to come to terms with those things within his own soul that could compromise his ministry, that could keep him from being faithful, that could, if he is unaware of them and their power, give him the opportunity and the temptation to abuse the power he has. And so he does three things in the wilderness. He discovers the more sinister, the more darker aspects of his own soul. He names those darker aspects. Then he invites God to help him put boundaries around them. He doesn't ask God to take them away. He doesn't ask God to take them away. Just to put boundaries around them, so that they do not have the power to corrupt what he does, so that he has the power to make the choices he needs to make. And of course, Matthew ends by suggesting angels came and ministered to him. And I always had this vision of the angels and Jesus knitting these boundaries, these healthy boundaries around these things. And you know, these things are really interesting, you know, turning stone into food. Henry Nouwen says that's the temptation, the desire to be relevant. I think that's a real interesting play on that. Jesus wants to be relevant and could use his power to make himself more famous and relevant than he needs to be made. And then, of course, you have the going to the top of the temple and threatening to throw himself off so as to test God. And that's the temptation to be morally certain about things. You know, if we can be morally certain about things, we don't need God. I mean, God's there to help us sort of find our way and to help us explore the nuances of the life we've been given. And if we can be morally certain about what is absolutely right and absolutely wrong every step of the way, then why do we need God? And so in essence, the temptation is to sacrifice the need for faith. And of course, the third one is to become ruler of the world, to see all the people. And to institute a political order. And if he falls prey to that institute, that temptation, then that will compromise his mission. If he falls prey to any of these things, that he can abuse his power. And if Jesus abuses his power, who could stand in the midst of that? Who could be strong enough to stand against that? No one. But if Jesus puts those passions in some sense of control and boundaries around them, then he's free to do what God wants him to do. Be a healing presence, not a destructive one. And so we have this season of Lent. The church in its tradition has this season of Lent where we are invited by our faith tradition to follow Jesus into those desert places in our lives, to name those darker, more sinister aspects of ourselves. And you know, they're all different. Each of us have our own collection of them. Some of us may be driven by fears and anxieties, and some of us might be driven by passions that get out of control, and some of us may be driven by feelings of inadequacy and doubt, or maybe some of us are driven by feelings that we're better and superior, and those things need to be discovered and named and identified, and then we ask God to help us put some boundaries around them so they don't control us, so we control them. And that's part of the Lenten discipline. That's part of the way, since the 5th century, the church has tried to help people deal with their own interior lives, their own souls, and their own spirit. Discovering, naming, seeking some healthy boundaries. Because even though we may not have the power that Jesus had, we have power. And we can do some damage. We can hurt. It's an old expression in the church. Hurt people hurt people. A psychotherapist once told me that when somebody is severely abused in a family, it takes 2.5 generations to undo that abuse. Think about that. Now, my grandparents were pretty gentle souls. And my dad was a very gentle soul. And if, on the other hand, one of my grandparents viciously attacked someone in the family, abused someone in the family, the idea that 2.5 generations to clean that up, my daughter is still dealing with that. My 28-year-old daughter is still dealing with that. And over 40 years of ministry, I can tell you I've seen families that have had generations of pain and sadness that can be tracked back to collection of abusive events. Everyone in this room holds that kind of power. Everyone in this room can create that kind of pain. I can, you can, we all can. And that's why the season of Lent has been given to us. It's not that our darker sides make us evil. It isn't. I do not believe that when we talk about the Adam and Eve story and the fallenness of our humanity, that means we are inherently evil. We are not. But there are forces within our humanity that we have to know and identify and confess. And if we don't, we become vulnerable to their destructive behavior. So this season isn't about trying to help us beat ourselves up, but help us become better people by knowing who and what we are. By calling on God to help us identify those weaknesses and anxieties and fears and whatever that create in us behaviors that might be destructive. And you know, the thing about it is, every year we do this, which is telling us it is a lifetime work. But the more we do it this year, the less we'll have to do it next year. And the more we do it next year, the less we'll have to do it the year after that, and the year after that. Because eventually we grow into people who become Christ-like. This is not working for our salvation. This is working for a way of life that reflects the power and grace of our salvation. So every year we begin the first Sunday of Lent with our annual trek into the wilderness, into the desert places of our lives. And we are given this promise that if we do this, Christ will be there with the angels to help us along. Know that you are loved, and know that each of you are a blessing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.